want to look today a little bit at the life of Isaac. And we've looked at Abraham a little bit and Lot, and we've even looked at some tests that have gone on with the children in the wilderness. We started to kind of look through some characters in the Old Testament, and I want to continue this series throughout the year, and it'll probably be integrated with other things. But we want to start looking at these characters and see what kind of lessons that we can learn. And Isaac, even before his birth, you see that he was a son of promise and he was a son of prophecy. And then he was miraculously brought into existence by God's hand when his parents were past the age of childbearing. So we see when God first came to Abraham and gave him the promise in Genesis chapter 12, Abraham was 75 years old and he called him out of Ur of the Chaldeans, and he wanted him to go into a land that he would show him, where he said he was going to make his name great, he was going to make him a great nation, and that all the families of the earth were going to be blessed in Abraham. Now that promise necessitated there be an heir to Abraham. And so Abraham, as time went on and the years went by, he didn't hear from God for a while, and he began to think about who this heir could be. And the first thing that he thought he had figured it out was Eliezer of Damascus. If you would, turn your Bible to Genesis chapter 15 is where we'll kind of start. He thought he was going to have this heir, which was one of the servants' children that were born into his house. And he says here in Genesis 15, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, "Do not fear, Abram. I am a shield to you. Your reward shall be very great." Abram said, "O Lord God, what will you give me, since I am childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus?" And Abram said, "Since you have given no offspring to me, one born in my house is my heir." So in his mind, he realizes that this promise does necessitate an heir, but since he's childless, it's got to be this boy who was born to one of his servants in his household. But God says in verse 4, he says, "This man will not be your heir, but one who will come forth from your own body shall be your heir." And he reiterates some of the promise about how numerous these people who are coming from him are going to be. And so then Abraham has some more time to think about, what is God going to do? God works on his own timetable here. And so he's, from the time he first called Abraham, it's going to be 25 years before that boy comes. So Abraham initially thought it was going to be Eliezer. More time passes, and him and his wife have been thinking about this. It's going to be an heir from my own body. And Sarah has that great idea, right? Not really. And she says, "I'll give you my maid. You can go into her, conceive a child with her, and that's how this heir can come from your body." And they put the plan into action. And so Abraham conceives with her maid, and they end up bringing forth Ishmael. And then Ishmael is raised up to 13 years old. And in Abraham and Sarah's mind, he's still the child that is going to be the progenitor of God's blessing. Look at Genesis chapter 17. Genesis 17, beginning in verse 15. "Then God said to Abraham, 'As for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and indeed I will give you a son by her. Then I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of peoples will come from her.'" Now, God hadn't been specific about this. He's been giving pieces. There's going to be an heir. It's not going to be Eliezer. It's coming from your body. Now he says it's coming from Sarah, your wife. And you can imagine what Abraham must have felt when he realized that was God's plan. Abraham fell on his face and laughed and said in his heart, "Will a child be born to a man 100 years old? And will Sarah, who is 90 years old, bear a child?" And Abraham said to God, "Oh, that Ishmael might live before you." But God said, "No, but Sarah, your wife, will bear you a son, and you shall call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant for his descendants after him." So it's not going to be Ishmael. If you were to drop down in that same chapter, verse 24, Abraham was 99 years old when he was circumcised. Verse 25, Ishmael was 13. So for 13 years, they were thinking, as this boy was being raised up to adolescent, he is the heir. And then God speaks to him again and says, "Not so. It's going to be from your wife, Sarah's womb that a child will be born, and he laughs. And later, Sarah also laughs, which is where Isaac gets his name from. God gave him the name Isaac, which is meaning laughter. And she even says when he's born that people who hear about this will laugh with me. And you can imagine the great joy that his birth brought to them in their elderly years, having been without a child all these years. What a joy and what a blessing it must have been. So after the birth and after the feast, he was weaned and they had a feast. And the next thing we read about in Isaac's life is when God called to Abraham to take his only begotten son, Isaac, and bring him up the mountain, Mount Moriah, and sacrifice him on an altar as a burnt offering. And so Abraham, he obeyed God, and he got things ready, and he took and made the journey, and took his son and servants and a donkey packed with wood, and they went there to make that sacrifice on that mountain. And you know, when you look at that, there's plenty of sermon material there. Maybe one day we'll go back there and preach on that. When you look at that occasion, that's a foreshadow of Christ going to the cross, when Isaac went up that mountain with his father. Just consider the parallels. Some commentators say Isaac was probably an adolescent. I don't think so. Josephus, the Jewish historian, says that Isaac was probably 25 years old. I agree with, and this is really just an opinion, you can't prove it one way or the other, but I agree with Barnes, who said that he was probably 33 years old, the same age as Jesus. And I believe there were two men of faith on that mountain as he consented to go and become that sacrifice. Listen to a couple of the parallels that we have with Isaac and Jesus. Isaac and Christ are both called the only begotten son. Both of them carried wood up a mountain. Isaac carried the wood for that sacrifice, and Jesus carried the crossbeam as he went up the hill. Moriah and Calvary are the exact same mountain geographically. Isaac and Jesus both consented to death. They were both bound. They were both laid on the wood. They were both being put to death by their father. And both of them were dead for 3 days and three nights. Jesus literally, and Isaac figuratively, in the mind of Abraham when he heard the news to the time he took him to that mountain. And Isaac did not decide to fight against his father and the will of God. He willingly said, okay. And he laid down his life on that altar. And of course, we know God provided a great sacrifice in this place. So then when he's 40 years of age, his mother passes away. And he grieves his mother, and his father decides he needs some comfort. So he sends his servant to go to a land where his people are at and take for him a wife. And they get Rebekah. And Rebekah is brought to Isaac, and he's able to be comforted. He was very respectful of his parents, and he was a man of great faith in God. And so Isaac also is the only patriarch who kept God's plan for marriage in its original form. He was the only one who kept one wife and continued to remain faithful in those vows that in his life. Another scene is when he bestows the birthright upon his son, Jacob. And we might ask this question, why in the world would he ever have been planning to bestow the birthright upon Esau instead of Jacob? And several reasons we might ask that. Number one, he had to have known about the prophecy that was given to his wife. When God came to Rebekah before the birth of those boys, the Lord said to her, two nations are in your womb, and two peoples will be separated from your body, and one people shall be stronger than the other, and the other and the older shall serve the younger. And by the way, not only would he have been aware of that prophecy, he also surely would have been aware of the kind of lifestyle that Esau was living. Esau, if you read the Hebrews account, in Hebrews 12:16, it says that he was a fornicator and a profane person, or an immoral and godless man. Profane means that you have nothing to do with sacred things, religious things, spiritual things. You have more to do with the secular things, and you have those things as a mainstay in your life. That's the kind of man he was. And then on top of that, he married two Hittite women and was a polygamist, and his parents surely didn't approve of that, as they had been brought together because of people who cared about making a marriage inside of the lineage. And so to emphasize just how much he didn't care about spiritual things, there's that event when he sold his birthright. He traded that spiritual and sacred birthright for a bowl of stew. And so he made that grave mistake. And then when it was time to have the birthright, you remember Jacob impersonated his brother Esau? He came in before his father Isaac when he was basically blind. And his father was kind of curious, are you really my son? You know, he was asking some pointed questions there. And Isaac said to his son, how is it that you have it so quickly? You know, he just sent him out to go hunt for this game that he was going to cook up. How did you get it so quickly? And he said, because the Lord your God caused it to happen to me. Jacob would have had to have been very careful to make sure that his words would have been displaced as though they were Esau's words. And notice how he words that, the Lord your God. You see, because the truth was, Yahweh was Isaac's God, not Esau's God. He doesn't say the Lord our God or the Lord God, it's the Lord your God. So he was no longer even worshiping God. And I think when Abraham blessed those boys and he switched his hands, I think he knew that there was something there. So why was Isaac so determined to make Esau the recipient of the blessings? It seemed that he was blinded by his partiality among these boys. There was a partiality among those parents. The wife favored Jacob and Isaac favored Esau. And we read in Genesis 25:28, Isaac loved Esau because he had a taste for game. That's certainly an interesting reason why you would love somebody, because he had a taste for game. But there's all kinds of reasons why someone might displace favoritism. So once this blessing was bestowed upon Jacob, there was no amount of tears, there was no amount of pleading, there was no amount of begging that was going to reverse it. And there is a stark warning in the Hebrews letter for us if we have chosen in our life to trade our spiritual inheritance in eternity for some bowl of stew, whatever it might be. Something in this world that is more valuable to us than those spiritual blessings that God has in eternity. Once that day comes and he pronounces those who are to receive the inheritance and those who have traded their bowl or traded their inheritance for a bowl of soup, whatever that is, there will not be any amount of tears or pleading or begging that would reverse it. And that's the warning we get from Esau. So all of that, and then at the end of Isaac's life, obviously there's a record of his death in Genesis 35. We want to look at all of that as in kind of like information to provide us a background or a snapshot of his life. But I want to take you for the rest of our time to one chapter, and let's zoom in on this chapter and look at something we can learn from his life. Go with me to Genesis chapter 26. We're going to kind of walk down through this chapter together, and you'll see several points, and we'll make some applications at the end here. The first thing we see that happens here in this chapter is there's a famine. And so anytime there's a famine, people, especially in the Middle Eastern territories, whenever there is a famine where there's hardly any rain anyways, it becomes extremely scarce. And so people migrate toward bigger cities because they've got more reservoir, they've got more water on hand that can supply people. And so these little communities and little villages sort of dry up. Cisterns are relied upon, wells, and even the famine can last so long that those things begin to dry up. And so a lot of people go towards the biggest places. So there's a famine in the land, and water has become a very serious commodity, sort of like when the pandemic started and you couldn't find water in the supermarket. You couldn't even find toilet paper. A bottle of hand sanitizer was going for hundreds of dollars. It was kind of like that. Whoever had the water was in high demand, right? Look at chapter 26 here, and let's begin in verse 1. Now there was a famine in the land, besides the previous famine that had occurred in the days of Abraham. So Isaac went to Gerar to Abimelech, king of the Philistines. And the Lord appeared to him and said, do not go down to Egypt. Stay in the land of which I shall tell you. Sojourn in this land, and I will be with you and bless you. For to you and to your descendants I will give all these lands, and I will establish the oath which I swore to your father Abraham. I will multiply your descendants as the stars of heaven, and I will give your descendants all these lands. And by your descendants all the nations of the earth shall be blessed, because Abraham obeyed me and kept my charge, my commandments, my statutes, and my laws. So he lived in Gerar. So what we see here is he's left where he was because of the famine, and he comes to Gerar, which is a city of Philistines, and Abimelech is the king there. So he's coming into this city, and obviously he's on his way toward Egypt, and God steps in and says, don't go any further. Don't go down to Egypt. That's where most people would go to, because that's even bigger. Surely you'll have water there. And God warns his people later in the narrative of Israel's history not to go to Egypt, and they don't listen. Bad things happen. But Isaac listens to God. He doesn't go to Egypt. He's going to set up his camp right here in Gerar and dwell with these people. And God says, if you'll do that, I'll bless you. I'll multiply you, and everything will go according to plan. So he trusts God, and he lives in Gerar. Now, the only stain that we find in this chapter, it's such a beautiful chapter, but there is a little stain here on Isaac's record. And the Bible doesn't give us just the good. It gives the good, the bad, and the ugly. And so God just tells us the reality about his servants. And so what we see here is he makes the same mistake as his father, and he lies about his wife being his sister out of fear that he might be killed. You see this beginning in verse 7. It says, when the men of the place asked about his wife, he said, she is my sister. For he was afraid to say, my wife, thinking the men of the place might kill me on account of Rebekah, for she is beautiful. Now notice verse 8. It came about when he had been there a long time. I don't know how long a long time is. Was it 6 months? Was it a year? Was it more than a year? We don't know. But whatever a long time is, he had to keep up this kind of charade for a while, you know, that they weren't really together. So that would have put a strain on things. But eventually things always kind of come to the surface, don't they? And as it would be, Abimelech, king of the Philistines, looked out through a window and saw, and behold, Isaac was caressing his wife Rebekah. Then Abimelech called Isaac and said, behold, certainly she is your wife. How then did you say she is my sister? And Isaac said to him, because I said I might die on account of her. Abimelech said, what is this you have done to us? One of the people might easily have lain with your wife, and you would have brought guilt upon us. So Abimelech charged all the people, saying, he who touches this man or his wife shall surely be put to death. Wow. So Abimelech sees them together and acting in a way that brothers and sisters don't act. And so Abimelech's quite a guy. He doesn't want to incur guilt. He doesn't want there to be anything bad happening to him. So he's at least a man with some kind of integrity here. And he tells Isaac, why would you do this? God emphasizes again to Isaac that he had nothing to fear. Things would have been fine had he came there and said, she's my wife, and we're looking for a place to find water and residence. But instead, out of fear, oftentimes as we do, and even as children do, when they think there's going to be a big punishment involved, and you ask them a question about something, and you say, what happened? They will sometimes lie, because they are afraid that their backside is going to get spanked. And in this case, he was afraid that his skin was going to be, you know, killed. He was going to die. So he decided to lie, and later he realizes the same thing I think Abraham realized. God is a shield to you. Do not fear, as he said in chapter 15. So this happens, but then after that, we begin to see what takes place with him in his relationship with these people. And that's where I really want you to make some applications with me in this. So here he is living in Gerar. Now he doesn't have to keep up any pretense anymore. He's able to live and dwell with his wife in peace. Nobody's going to touch him. They're all under the threat of death. You don't touch this man or his wife. And so everything is good. He's being blessed and prospered by God. But then some things begin to happen. Look at verse 12 with me. It says, Isaac sowed in that land. So he's having gardens and so forth and planting. And he reaped in the same year 100-fold. That's a good increase. And the Lord blessed him, and the man became rich. Well, he already had the inheritance of his father, and his father was extremely wealthy. So now he's already rich, but he becomes rich. And he continued to grow richer until he became very wealthy or great. And anytime somebody gets extremely wealthy, they become powerful. They become a powerful individual. Okay? And so this is his circumstance. He had possessions of flocks and herds and a great household so that the Philistines envied him. Now all the wells which his father's servants had dug in the days of Abraham his father, the Philistines stopped up by filling them with earth. Then Abimelech said to Isaac, go away from us, for you are too powerful for us. And Isaac departed from there and camped in the valley of Gerar and settled there. So initially these Philistines are watching this, and I don't know how powerful he became. Maybe he was rivaling the king himself. He might have become so wealthy and so powerful that he, you know, on this occasion, why doesn't Isaac take a stand? I mean, he was certainly powerful enough to say, we're too powerful for you, listen. And who wouldn't have decided to take a stand and say, no, we're going to stay here. This is where we're going to be, and this is my land, and you better stand down. He didn't do that. He didn't fight for his right to continue to have that well and to continue to have that land. He just said, okay. And he decided to pack up his bags. He packed up his family. He packed up his servants. He packed up his flocks and his herds, and he went out. Where did he go? Well, he goes out into the valley. Well, what happens then? Well, let's keep reading. So he leaves from this occasion where there was envy, and isn't that what typically happens? You know, that this drives a wedge. Then verse 18, look at this. Then Isaac dug again the wells of water which had been dug in the days of his father. So he had previously dug. In the time of a famine, he shows up in town, and guess what? His father had all these wells in their land. And they were all pouring with water, but the Philistines, after Abraham died, decided to bury them all with dirt. So how dumb is that? Now there's no water. Well, Isaac shows up in their land, and he decides he was going to dig a well. So he digs the well, and he's got water for his crops, and he's blessed, and they envy him, and he's becoming too powerful, and then they run him out. So he goes out into the valley, and he digs again. He finds another well of his father, right? So he digs that up, and it says the Philistines stopped them up after the death of Abraham. He gave them the same names which his father had given them. But when Isaac's servants dug in the valley and found there a well of flowing water, the margin says living water, the herdsmen of Gerar quarreled with the herdsmen of Isaac, saying, the water is ours. So he named the well Essek, because they contended with him. The idea here, contended, means contention or strife. And so there was strife. It's the same picture between Lot's herdsmen and Abram's herdsmen, and then they, you know, separated. And Abram was the gracious man to give his nephew the right of way. But in this circumstance, Isaac is being contended with by the herdsmen on the field. I imagine he could have made a pretty strong case for saying, no, this water is actually mine. In fact, let's look back and see. Number one, my father Abraham is the one who originally dug this well. Number two, you guys buried it. Number three, the king just told me I needed to leave, and so I came out here and dug it. And if we need to, we can go talk to the king, and I'm sure he's going to see fit to give this well to me as my water. Why didn't he do that? And I submit to you, it's because Isaac wanted peace more than he wanted the material possessions of this earth. He was a man who wanted peace. He wanted peace, and so he was willing to be inconvenienced. He was willing to suffer the loss. He was willing to let it go. And he was willing to say, you know what? You can have it. You can have it. I just want to have peace. And so that's what he did. He moved on from there. And what did he do next? Well, look at verse 21. It says, then they dug another well. So this is the third one. He dug one when he was in Gerar, first one in the valley, and this is the third one. And they quarreled over it too. So he named it Sitnah, which means enmity, is also translated hatred. Notice the progression of terminology that we're seeing here and the lesson that you can learn. So initially it was envy, right? There was envy or there was jealousy while he was in Gerar. And that led to them kind of fearing him. And then eventually they said, we don't want to be around you anymore. Then it leads to strife. And then it leads to hatred. And isn't that what happens in relationships sometimes? It starts out, somebody's envious of somebody else. Maybe it's their blessings. Maybe it's something they've got going on. Maybe whatever it is, they become envious of the individual. And then eventually, after envy, then there's some kind of strife. There's some kind of quarreling that's going on, and there's a contention there. And if left unchecked and unsolved, it goes on to just a pure hatred. You just have a hatred for the individual in your heart. But Isaac wasn't that way. Isaac was willing to stand down and take the high road, and he continued to move his family. So this third time, how inconvenient must he have been? This man's so wealthy, he's got to look after all of his family, all of his servants, all the flocks, all the herds, and I mean, he's got more than probably anybody there, and he's packing up all of his stuff, and he's willing to move on. And you can imagine the people that he's looking after are probably like, what are we doing? Are we moving again? Where are we going? Well, Isaac said, we're going to go and find a new place. So he goes on down the road. Well, where does he go? Look at verse 22. He moved away from there and dug another well. This was number 4. And they did not quarrel over it. So he named it Rehoboth. For he said, at last, the Lord has made room for us. Which is what that means, room or a broad place. And we will be fruitful in the land. And so I don't know if God had been testing him. He surely was passing the test as he continued to take the high road and allow them to have it. He just said, that's fine, you guys can have it, I'll move on. And so here he is, finally able to be blessed, and he gives God the credit. He recognizes the Lord has made this place available to us. But he doesn't stay there. It says, then he went up from there to Beersheba, and the Lord appeared to him in the same night and said, I am the God of your father Abraham. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bless you and multiply your descendants for the sake of my servant Abraham. So he built an altar there and called upon the name of the Lord and pitched his tent there, and there Isaac's servants dug a well. Now this is interesting because this is the 5th well that he's dug and struck water. I mean, it's said that you could easily have followed Abraham if you had drone footage, because you would have been able to see the smoke of his altars everywhere he went in the land. You remember when we looked at Abraham's life, one of the things that were emphasized in the text over and over and over, everywhere he went, what did he do? He built an altar. Then he went here and he built an altar. He went here and he built an altar. When you look at Isaac's life, it's fascinating because everywhere he went, he built a well, or he dug a well. So he goes here, he digs the well. He goes here, he digs the well. Abraham is really a picture of the Father, you know, God the Father. And then when you look at Isaac, it's a picture of the Son. And when Abraham is a picture of the Father, you see what's emphasized is worship. And when you look at Isaac as a picture of the Son, what's emphasized is this life-giving water. Water that provides in a time of drought, in a time of famine, and it refreshes and it vitalizes and gives us life. And so it's very fascinating. And we'll see more when we get to Jacob eventually, and we'll tie it all up together. But so he gets here to Beersheba, and the Lord then speaks to him. And the Lord assures him that everything is in place. Things are according to plan. He still stands to be blessed, just as God promised his father. And then something very interesting happens as he lives in Beersheba. He's got there. He builds this altar. God appears and talks with him. His servants go out to dig a well. They're not even done digging the well yet. They're out in the field digging the well. And then this happens in the midst of this. Abimelech, the king of the Philistines, shows up. And he comes with his advisor and the commander of his army. So he comes with his little entourage, and they show up in Beersheba where Isaac is camped. And notice what happens in verse 26. So they show up. Abimelech came to Gerar with his advisor and the commander of his army. And Isaac said to them, why have you come to me since you hate me and have sent me away from you? What are you guys doing here? You know, you guys drove me out. You guys don't like me. And they said, we see plainly that the Lord has been with you. So we said, let there now be an oath between us, even between you and us. Let us make a covenant with you. And you will do us no harm, just as we have not touched you and have done nothing to you but good and sent you away in peace. You are now the blessed of the Lord. Then he made them a feast, and they ate and drank. In the morning they arose and exchanged oaths, and Isaac sent them away, and they departed from him in peace. Now it came about on the same day when Isaac's servants came in and told him about the well which they had dug, and they said, we have found water. What good news this day had brought him. After all the struggles and after all those moves and after every well that he dug, he gets to this place. God speaks to him, and he builds this altar, and he's rejoicing. God's promise has been laid out. And then they go out to dig a well, and Abimelech shows up. And he says, listen, we can see that God is with you, and we want to have an oath of peace. You know, he could have said at that point, you know what? I don't think so. I think you guys have put your cards on the table, and I don't want to have peace with you. You guys are not the kind of people I want to have peace with. God's going to continue to bless me, and I'm going to carry out his promises, and you guys go back to your land and forget about that. But he doesn't do that. He wants peace, and so what does he do? He says, let's have a feast, and let's make our oaths, and let's eat and drink together. And you can imagine the joy he must have been feeling. God spoke to him. These people came to have peace with him. And then his servants come in and they say, hey, we got water. And he's probably just like, thank you, Lord. All of this, you know, I don't know about you, but this demonstrates something very meaningful to me. And it's a lesson that we all should be able to learn from this. You know, a peace agreement is oftentimes a time-consuming matter because some people are hard to get along with. And they may make it very difficult for us to have peace with them. But if we will respond the way Isaac did and take the higher road and not contend with them and not try to fight for some physical thing and not try to have our way and state our case and make it so that we can have whatever we want, what will end up happening is peace will occur eventually. And I don't know how much you might have to be willing to suffer. I don't know how much you might have to be willing to take from somebody. They may keep dishing it and dishing it and dishing it, and you may continue to put your head back and say, okay, that's fine. You go right ahead. But eventually, it gives us hope to read about Isaac's circumstance. These people who drove him out and hated him and contended with him, they eventually came to him and said, hey, we can see clearly that you're one of God's people and we want to be at peace with you. And there may be people in this world that you have relationships with. Maybe it's somebody you work with or somebody you live nearby or somebody in your family. And there's just not been any peace because they have been on you and on you or whatever it is. Maybe they're envious of you and you don't even know it. And so the way they treat you and you can't figure it out, why do they constantly go after me? You keep doing what Isaac did and eventually there may be an opportunity where they come and begin to seek peace. Where did Isaac find all this peace? I say the only reason Isaac had peace is because he had God. And the only way that we'll ever have peace is to have God. That's where peace begins. And so the first thing we have to do is have the right relationship with God. If we don't have peace with God, there's no way that we're going to be able to have peace with the people in this world, that we'll be able to take that high road that Isaac took as a man with a character after God. And so he didn't fight to spare his earthly life when he climbed that mountain with Abraham. You remember when his father and him were going up that mountain? This precedes this event in Gerar. He was going up that mountain and he was carrying that wood. And he said, Father, we've got wood and we have fire, but where's the sacrifice? And Abraham said, Son, God's going to provide the sacrifice. When they got to the top of that mountain, we're not given this detail, but at some point Abraham had to stand there and look at his son and say, Son, God has told me that you're to be the sacrifice. And he didn't fight. He didn't quarrel. He didn't try to stop that from happening. He was willing, in order to have peace, to lay down on that altar. And you know, the Prince of Peace that he foreshadowed did the same thing. When Jesus was being ridiculed and harassed by all those Jews who were envious of him as he taught and gained a following in the land, he continued to walk up that mountain with that cross on his back. He went all the way. He went all the way up there and he let them nail him to that cross. He laid himself aside so that there could be peace between God and man. And he gave us the opportunity of the peace of God that we can have. And once you are a child of God, once you obey the gospel and you've been washed in baptism from your sins and you raise up to walk in a newness of life, you become, as Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. As a child of God, you become a peacemaker. You then go about doing what Isaac did. You're trying to establish peace with people and with God. The psalmist said in Psalm 34:14, depart from evil and do good and seek peace and pursue it. Paul said in Romans 14, we pursue the things which make for peace and the building up of one another. Paul said in Romans 12, if possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. And the Hebrews writer said in Hebrews 12, pursue peace with all men and the sanctification without which no one will see the Lord. And so as a child of God, we're not to be quarrelsome. We are not to seek our own vengeance. We are to be willing to suffer hardship, to suffer slander, to suffer persecution, to suffer wrongdoing, to be willing to stand down and lay ourselves aside for the sake of peace. And when we do that, people will be brought to Christ by our example. They will see that God is truly with us. God will be glorified. So Isaac's example is for us, and Jesus' example is for us. Paul said it best, 1 Corinthians 10, 32 and 33. He said, give no offense either to Jews or to Greeks or to the church of God, just as I also please all men in all things, not seeking my own profit, but the profit of of the many so that they may be saved. In matters of doctrine, we need to contend earnestly with gentleness and reverence. When it comes to matters of opinion and matters of ego and things of that nature, we ought to stand down. And we ought to be willing to lay ourselves aside and be wronged and suffer the loss that there might be peace. A long time ago, there was a man who gave up his well, and he gave up his farm, and he gave up his inheritance in that land and his prosperity that he had there. He laid himself aside, and he went on for the sake of peace. And in the process, he heaped burning coals of fire on the heads of those that had selfishly wronged him. And eventually, their hearts melted, and they decided that they wanted to have peace. They finally realized their wrong and feared the God of Isaac and reached out to have peace. Isaac realized that there's a Father in heaven, the same thing we must realize, and that one day he would have to stand before the Father in heaven and give an account for the way that he had dealt with the people that he had come in contact with on this earth. And he knew that that was going to be a time of accountability. And we know the same thing is true. And so as we go about our daily lives, when somebody has something against us, when somebody has a problem with us, let us remember the example of Isaac and be willing to lay those things aside and let them have it. Whatever it might be, it's fine. We just want to have peace and go on and continue to worship God and do His will. And we know that God will reward us in the end and vindicate us. Maybe today you've been pricked by this lesson and you have a need that you want to deal with today. And you want to get something off your chest or off your shoulders, as it were. And you've been carrying around some burden of guilt that really is unnecessary. Jesus paid a price on that cross so that you could lay your burdens down at Calvary. And if you need to do that this morning, whether it is to return to the fold and become right with God again, or you need to obey the gospel initially so that you can have your sins forgiven and walk in newness of life, we invite you to come as we stand and as we sing.